approaches in the Northern Hemisphere. And a major decision. President Biden takes action to pardon all federal offenses of marijuana possession. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by the Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at Carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Horror, terror, and death today at a daycare center in northeastern Thailand. An attacker armed with guns and a knife stormed into the center and massacred at least 36 people. More than nine others were injured. It is now the deadliest mass murder in the nation's history. Stephanie Tsai has the details.
Most of the dead were children, some as young as 2 years old. Early reports said only a few victims survived. This witness was deeply shaken by what she saw.
He used his feet to kick the window, then he shot at the door. I thought he got inside. I ran to the kitchen. I was in shock. I didn't know what to do.
First responders described shattered innocence.
Nobody wants this to happen. We are used to seeing a large number of bodies. We've been through it before. But this incident is the most harrowing of all, as they are little kids who were still sleeping. They were in a place where they were supposed to be innocent, and I don't think that they will ever know what happened to them.
Officials said after the violence, the gunman fled the scene to his home, where he killed his wife and child before taking his own life. The suspect was identified as 34-year-old Panya Kamrob, a former police officer fired earlier this year due to drug charges. A motive has yet to be found. This was Thailand's deadliest rampage, surpassing a 2020 mass shooting in which a former soldier killed at least 28 people and wounded 58 at a military base and shopping mall. Though guns in Thailand are available, mass shootings are relatively uncommon. And firearms kill about 2 in 100,000 people in Thailand every year, versus the United States with 12 shooting deaths per 100,000. Today, Thailand's prime minister expressed his sadness surrounding the attack.
I've received a report. We're checking the motive. He might have something inside him, facing problems. I don't take anyone's side. This shouldn't happen. It definitely shouldn't happen. I feel deep sadness towards the victims and relatives. Nobody thought this would happen.
As locals rushed to a nearby hospital to donate blood, dozens of families were left mourning the loss of their littlest loved ones. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai.
Roughly 185,000 homes and businesses in Florida are still without electricity a week after Hurricane Ian ravaged the state. Utilities expect the power restoration to be nearly complete by Friday night, but they acknowledge that some areas are so badly damaged that it may not be safe to restore service. We'll take a closer look at the ongoing recovery efforts later in the program. The Biden administration pardoned thousands of Americans convicted on federal charges of simple possession of marijuana. The administration is encouraging governors to do the same. The president also directed his administration to review how marijuana is classified as a drug under federal law. We'll have more on this later in the program. Proud Boy member Jeremy Bertino pleaded guilty today in federal court to seditious conspiracy for his role in the January 6th insurrection. He's the first member of the far-right group to do so. Bertino could potentially be a key witness for the Justice Department when five other Proud Boy members stand trial on similar charges starting in December. Separately, a former member of the Oath Keepers testified today that the far-right group's founder claimed he was in contact with a Secret Service agent in the months leading up to the January 6th attack. John Zimmerman was called as a witness in the trial of Stuart Rhodes, the group's founder, who's charged with seditious conspiracy. There is word Republican Senator Ben Sasse of Nebraska will resign from office before the end of the year. He'll reportedly take a position as president of the University of Florida. Sasse was one of seven Republican senators who voted to convict former President Donald Trump over his role on January 6th. A federal judge has halted key provisions of New York's latest sweeping gun law. The judge said the law went too far in requiring applicants to turn over their social media information. The ruling also keeps in place restrictions that bar firearms in schools, government buildings, and places of worship, but says the state cannot ban guns from sensitive locations like Times Square. The U.S. Supreme Court overturned the state's previous gun law. South Korea says North Korea flew 12 warplanes near their shared border today, further ratcheting up tensions. The South responded by launching 30 warplanes of their own. All that came hours after North Korea fired two more ballistic missiles into the sea, its sixth round of missile tests in less than 2 weeks. In Seoul, South Korea's president condemned the repeated provocations and urged calm.
People could be worried, but our government will thoroughly take care of the people's lives and safety. Based on a strong South Korea-U.S. alliance and security cooperation between South Korea, the United States, and Japan.
As part of a joint Allied response, a U.S. aircraft carrier returned to the waters east of South Korea. Allied warships conducted a drill to simulate shooting down North Korea's missiles. At least 22 people are dead tonight after two boats packed with migrants sank off the Greek islands of Lesbos and Kythira. Dozens are still missing. Dramatic video captured local residents rescuing some of the migrants by using rope to pull them up cliffs. People from Afghanistan, Iraq, and Iran were among those rescued. Many of the dead were believed to be from African nations. Back in this country, more Americans filed for unemployment benefits last week, but the labor market overall remains strong. The Labor Department reported jobless claims rose to 219,000. That is up 29,000 from the previous week and the highest number in 4 months. Stocks, meanwhile, tumbled on Wall Street today as investors await tomorrow's job report for September. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 347 points to close at 29,927. The Nasdaq fell 75 points and the S&P 500 slipped 39. And the Nobel Prize for Literature was awarded today to a prominent French author for her uncompromising portraits of her life. Annie Ernaux has penned more than 20 books, mostly autobiographical works, that detail intimate life events, including abortion, illness, and the deaths of her parents. She's one of France's most honored authors and just the 17th woman to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. Still to come on the NewsHour, rescue and recovery efforts continue in the aftermath of Hurricane Ian. Scandinavia remains largely free of the firearm violence plaguing America despite high gun ownership. Documentarian Stanley Nelson discusses the enduring relevance of Harriet Tubman and Frederick Douglass, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
President Biden's executive action today on marijuana convictions and regulations is this administration's most significant action to date on drug reform. White House correspondent Laura Barrón-López has more.
President Biden laid out three steps today to end what he calls a failed approach on marijuana. He announced that pardons for past federal and District of Columbia convictions for marijuana possession, a call for governors to take the same action for state convictions, and he directed federal agencies to review whether marijuana should still be classified as one of the most dangerous drugs under federal law. Here with me now is Mark Osler. He is a law professor at the University of St. Thomas School in Minneapolis and a former federal prosecutor. Mark, thanks for joining us. So out of this announcement, what is the piece of it that could potentially have the biggest impact?
Probably the talk about rescheduling marijuana. The pardon is probably going to impact a relatively small number of people, most of whom had misdemeanors as their crime of conviction. In the broader scope of things, reconceiving exactly how dangerous marijuana is and how the feds approach it is the bigger story.
And so if the administration actually moves forward with descheduling marijuana, what immediate practical change would occur and what kind of timeline would we see?
Well, it's going to change the ability of federal authorities, for example, at the border, where a lot of these cases come, from prosecuting people simply for that. It's going to also send a message to the states as well. We will no longer have as much of a conflict between federal and state law on marijuana, especially in those states where marijuana has been legalized for recreational use.
And descheduling is effectively the same as decriminalization, correct?
Yes. There's other ways that marijuana is embedded in federal law and in the penal code. So there's going to be some cleaning up to do beyond simply descheduling. But yes, that's a big part of it.
We're very close to the midterm elections. You've talked to the White House and other officials within the administration. Why do you think they decided on this now?
It may have had political considerations taken into account, but it could be just that it took a while to get to the point where they're ready to pull the trigger on this, that there is a lot of people who have to check off on this kind of a decision, particularly within the Department of Justice, where they're pretty loath to give up control over anything. And so even the consideration of the scheduling of marijuana and such a relatively broad pardon is something that it probably took a while to get everybody in line to say yes to that.
Part of that decision on descheduling is also going to include the Health and Human Services Secretary. Is that a normal step, as far as you know?
Well, I think they're having broad consultation amongst the people whom it will affect. And the scheduling of any narcotic does affect, you know, health services, obviously. Right now, in Schedule 1, marijuana is what Schedule 1 means is that it has no medical use, no legitimate medical use. Now, obviously, the majority of the states disagree with that, where some medical use is allowed. And so in terms of using marijuana in a way that's consistent and the way that the government approaches it, Health and Human Services would have to be involved, and they want to get buy-in from them.
The other part of this announcement is that it will impact more than 6,500 individuals convicted between 1992 and 2001. So what is the reality for those 6,500 people who were previously convicted?
Yeah, it's going to affect their criminal record, that they've got a misdemeanor on their record. We're not talking about thousands of people walking out of prison. That's not what this is going to create. But instead, it's going to be thousands of people who have lived with a misdemeanor on their record that they have to report periodically, and that's going to be gone. Is that going to change the landscape of the war on drugs? Probably not. But it will mean something to those people who get that benefit.
That brings me to another issue with under marijuana convictions and potentially commutations. In April, President Biden commuted the sentences of 75 nonviolent drug offenders. Only 9 of those within the total commutations and pardons were for marijuana offenses. So there are roughly 2,700 nonviolent marijuana offenders in federal prison. Is that something that you think the administration could potentially move on either later this year or early next year?
Yes, I think so. And that's the obvious next step, is that right now, those are people that would have been convicted of trafficking offenses. Now, of course, a lot of times when people were convicted of trafficking offenses, they were doing things that are legal now. For example, there's one man, Lance Gloor, he was running a legal marijuana dispensary in the state of Washington. And so, yes, that is the logical next step to approach, and we're hoping that the administration will take that step.
And so what do you say to people who would argue that commuting the sentences of those offenders who potentially sold huge quantities of marijuana is not the right path to take?
Well, certainly there's other things that go with that kind of narcotic trafficking. And if you have a situation where there was violence associated with it, we can expect that they'll be treated differently. But for the most part, when we look at these cases, it's people who are doing things that are right now being done by companies across the country.
Very quickly, Mark, if I could ask you, you've told me before that you think the administration's path on this has been somewhat cautious. How does it stand up to prior presidents?
Well, let's compare this. The last real broad categorical pardon that we can compare this to is Jimmy Carter's broad amnesty that he gave to draft evaders. And that was much bolder because it granted much greater relief. He did it on the very first day he was in office, and it cut at something that was still controversial in American society, the way that marijuana possession.
10 seconds.
It's still not going bold, but we can hope that that'll be something that's considered in the future.
Mark Osler, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
In a meeting of OPEC Plus nations yesterday in Vienna, oil-producing countries including Saudi Arabia and Russia have agreed to cut oil production by 2 million barrels a day to lift sagging oil prices. The move is being seen as a big setback to the Biden administration just over 30 days before the midterms and as a salve to Russia, helping it raise its oil revenues and support its invasion of Ukraine. President Biden called it a disappointment and said his administration is looking for alternatives. To decode all of this, with me now is special correspondent Ryan Chilcote, who joins us from Ithaca, New York. Ryan, welcome back to the NewsHour. Good to see you. So the OPEC Plus nations see themselves as guardians of the stable energy market. Even the Saudi energy minister today said, we're here as a moderating force. This is going to bring stability to the market. What is that argument? Explain that to us. How does slashing production bring that about?
Yeah. Well, yeah, they like to think of themselves as the central bank of oil, if you will. And so their argument is that we're heading into a global recession and that as we move into that recession, the demand for oil is going to fall. So they are arguing it's best to preemptively remove that excess supply, those 2 million barrels, they say, so that we don't have a situation where the demand falls and, of course, the price falls as a result. And you can kind of understand where they're coming from, because if you look at between 2020 and 2022, we've seen oil prices go from everywhere between, I think it was in March of 2020, minus $40 a barrel. You actually had to pay people to take oil off your hands at the beginning of the pandemic, to as much as $130 earlier this year. So that $170 range is too much volatility. They say by doing this, they can smoothen out the price range, which is what they need as oil producing countries. Now, their critics will say, well, come on, they knew that the recession was coming. They know that this that there's an inflation problem, that this will only exacerbate the inflation problem. They are a very careful organization. They've spent much of the year already ratcheting up oil production by 400,000 barrels of oil each time. So a cut like 2 million barrels isn't any nuanced move. This is really, their critics would say, just about raising the oil price so they can make more money.
So, Ryan, there's a lot of focus on the Saudis, but Russia is a leader in this OPEC plus oil cartel as well. What does this mean for them, and what do we know about their role in this decision?
Yeah, you said it right there. So this is OPEC plus, because OPEC really ceased to be a meaningful institution in 2016 when OPEC plus was formed, when the Russians basically joined OPEC. The Russians and the Saudis are first amongst equals in OPEC plus. And the Russians, of course, are very interested in, or would have been interested in this supply cut, because they want a higher oil price, because and this doesn't really cost them anything, because a lot of their oil isn't making it to market in the first place because of the sanctions. So the oil that they are able to sell to India and to China, well, they want to try and get as high of a price for it as they can. So this was very much in their interest, and that's exactly why the Russian deputy prime minister, who was just sanctioned last week by the United States on the back of Russia's attempted annexation of those four regions in Ukraine, traveled to Vienna and helped forge this deal together with the Saudis.
What does all this mean for consumers, especially here in the U.S.? We've been seeing gas prices ticking down steadily since those summer peaks. What does a slash in production mean for what's ahead?
Well, it means higher prices at the pump, because what you've seen this year over the last 4 months is the price of oil fall by about 20%. And there's almost a direct influence between what crude oil costs and what you pay for it after refining. So if the price goes up, and there are people that are saying now oil is going to go well over $100 a barrel, then you will see the price at the pump go up as well.
What about what the president can do? I mean, we heard him say earlier today he's disappointed, but they're looking at alternatives. What can President Biden do at this point?
Yeah, it's a tough one. The president was asked today about Venezuela. Could Venezuela provide more oil to the market? Might that help things? Venezuela, of course, has the world's largest oil reserves, even more than Saudi Arabia, but is locked out of the market because of sanctions. But I think the concern with Venezuela would be that it's been out of the market for so long, its infrastructure so degraded, all of the investment gone, many of the engineers have fled, that it would take a good while for Venezuela to add a sufficient amount of oil to the market to really make a difference. I think, you know, the interesting thing is that in the United States, there will be a lot of energy companies, a lot of oil producers saying, hey, if you're looking for a solution, we're part of it, Biden administration, because they've been complaining a lot that they're not being heard by the Biden administration. In fact, I was at an energy conference just a couple of weeks ago, and the CEO of a U.S. oil company was saying just that. He was asked whether, you know, what kind of dialogue U.S. oil producers have with the Biden administration. He said, we have no dialogue at all. So they see themselves as part of the solution, but they feel like because they're the bad guys in the energy transition, the climate change conversation, they're ignored.
Meanwhile, Americans are left to wonder what comes next and bracing for potentially higher prices at the pump. Ryan Chilcote, special correspondent, joining us tonight from Ithaca, New York. Thank you, Ryan.
Thank you.
More than a week after Hurricane Ian blasted through Florida, there are still many questions surrounding recovery, relief, and rebuilding. William Brangham continues our coverage.
Amna, search efforts for the missing or dead are still ongoing in some of the hardest hit communities in southwestern Florida. Lee County Sheriff Carmine Marcino made that clear this afternoon.
This search could go on for a month. It could go on for a length of time. When there's no one there, the searches are happening. We checked over 3,500 twice, okay? We're wrapping up very, very soon, and I realize their frustration, okay? As soon as possible, I want to be back to the new norm, and I want that information out there. We gotta get through this as soon as possible, working around the clock.
And while the situation has improved for many, housing, food, and electricity are still in short supply. Chessa Latifi is a senior program advisor with Project Hope, which is an international nonprofit that provides relief during disasters and health crises. Chessa, thank you so much for joining us. I see you're obviously on the road there in the backseat of a car. Can you just give us a sense of how things are in the places that you're working right now?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having us. We've been seeing so much. The areas that we've really been working in are the more marginalized communities that were really lacking resources even prior to Hurricane Ian and are currently still lacking resources. These areas still do not have water. They still do not have electricity. These homes that were destroyed are the way that I keep saying this is it's a three little pigs metaphor. Your house was made of brick. Your house was fine, but if it was made of straw and stick, it's gone. And so these are the people that we're seeing that need the most support, the ones that didn't have much to begin with.
And can you tell us a little bit about some of those people? I know you're interacting with them one-on-one. What are you hearing? What are their situations like?
I met a gentleman named James yesterday whose his home was, it was when I say it was completely demolished, there was nothing there that was left. I spoke to him and his brother pretty extensively, and the hurricane had ripped the roof off and then tore the walls apart on his home. And, you know, the first thing he said to us said, I can't find my false teeth, right? And so just basic dignity. He didn't have any more. And then worse, he didn't have his glucometer, he didn't have his insulin, and he'd been without that since the hurricane hit a week ago. We were able to provide him with basic hygiene items and point him in the direction of the mobile clinic that we're supporting down the street, as well as a glucometer and strips to be able to test his insulin. But he needs a lot more than just that.
And for people like that, is it that there aren't shelters or clinics that are available for them to go to, or they're choosing not to go? What's the hang up there?
They can't access them. They just can't access them. You know, when their homes were destroyed, their cars were destroyed if they had a car. And, you know, they're a little bit in a more remote area of where the hurricane has hit. And so just the accessibility to either the major shelters or distribution points or clinics, it's just not there. And so they keep telling us, we're just waiting for help. We're waiting for help.
And is it your sense that that help is there? I mean, we hear these reports from the local county officials, from the governor, mm-hmm. from mayors, from FEMA. Is it your sense that authorities are doing everything that they can to help these people?
I do think that they're doing everything that they can, and there is so much centralized support, right? If you are able to access those resources, they do exist, but outside of those central resources, it's just not there.
And so what are, going forward, you mentioned this one man's sort of striking example, what are the more pressing needs for the broader population that you're working with?
Healthcare is going to be really, really important, right? You see a high level of non-communicable disease, so diabetes and hypertension. And so, you know, I think a lot of people think about the acute needs that may be injury or trauma in an event like this, but it's going to be these long-term needs. And I can't tell you how many people we've spoken to, you know, today and yesterday that still don't have their insulin and haven't had that for days, which is just a very, very dangerous situation. Basic hygiene items, water, right? The water supply has been disrupted. You cannot drink the drinking water if you even have access to the drinking water. A lot of the communities that we are in have well water, and so it's undrinkable. And so these are, you know, that is also has the potential to spread disease. One of the areas that we're working in right now, there are families that are sleeping in their homes without roofs. Right. And so the children are covered in just mosquito bites everywhere. It's supposed to rain this weekend. You know, there's a lot of despair out here.
I know from your background that you have traveled all over the world and responded to crises in a lot of different countries under a lot of different awful circumstances. How does this stack up in comparison?
How this is different is the level of poverty and how isolated these people are. I've never seen anything like this. I've worked all over the world, and they're just so isolated, and the storm has managed to isolate them even more. And you know, there's so much help going out to so many communities, but these marginalized communities are not seeing much of it, if any, at all. There's so many times that we've come to communities with basic hygiene items and they'll say, you're the first ones. You're the first ones that have been here, which is amazing considering how many people have descended onto Florida to help.
All right, that is Chessa Latifi of Project Hope. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks for having me.
The war in Ukraine is grinding towards winter. Now, even as Vladimir Putin lays false claim to more Ukrainian land, Ukraine's forces continue their counteroffensives across the east and the south. But the cost in human life and terror for the people of Ukraine continue to mount day by day.
In a region that Russia claimed as its own, targets today once again were civilians. Emergency workers rushed to save anyone stuck underneath the rubble after 7 Russian missiles hit the southern city of Zaporizhia. Entire residential buildings crushed in another brutal attack.
13-year-old Vladislav survived, but is now homeless.
I didn't understand what was happening. It was as if I were in the middle of a fog. I don't know how to describe this feeling. I was very afraid.
Zaporizhia's regional governor said at least three people were killed, but he remained defiant.
The enemy is terrorizing a peaceful population. We will hold on and we'll win. All will be Ukraine.
President Vladimir Putin invaded to prevent that and signed laws this week that illegally annex four Ukrainian regions into Russia, including Zaporizhia. Europe's largest nuclear plant is there, seized by Russia in early March. The plant is still operated by Ukrainian engineers, but yesterday, Russia's leader declared it was, quote, federal property. For months, Ukrainian and UN officials have warned of a potential nuclear catastrophe after explosions inside the plant. Today, the director of the UN nuclear watchdog, Rafael Grossi, said an accident was still possible.
We are here in a conflict. We are here in a war. We want this war to stop. The war should stop immediately. And of course, the position of the IAEA is that this facility is a Ukrainian facility.
Speaking in Prague to a new club of European nations, President Volodymyr Zelensky condemned Russia's actions.
Absolute meanness, absolute evil. There have already been thousands of manifestations of such evil. Unfortunately, there may be thousands more.
Russia's recent drafting of more than 200,000 reservists means newly mobilized soldiers like these are now training to join the war.
The guys are in combat mode. Everybody understands that the motherland asks for their help, and we will fulfill our duty.
Ukraine's military sees its duty as liberating territory seized by Moscow and unleashed a new counteroffensive in the southern Kherson region, where officials say they've retaken more than 150 square miles of territory in less than a week. These soldiers near Kherson filmed the moment Russian forces surrendered to Ukrainian troops. But the bulk of their advances have been in the east, where Ukrainian troops last weekend claimed victory in Lyman. There, Russian troops retreated so quickly, they even left the bodies of their own dead lying on the ground. The city is now in ruins after more than 4 months of Russian occupation. Hundreds of hungry residents who survived weeks sheltering inside have now emerged for the first time, desperate to receive humanitarian aid.
We want the war to come to an end. Want the pharmacy and shops to start working as they used to do, as well as hospitals. Everything is destroyed and pillaged. A complete disaster.
A Russian disaster that's left millions of Ukrainians internally displaced, in need of food and shelter, and now heat for the long and hard winter to come.
Today's daycare center massacre in Thailand points again to just how rare these mass shootings are outside of the United States, where this year alone there have been more than 500. Survivors of Norway's deadliest ever massacre in 2011 are urging the U.S. to tighten gun laws to try to end school shootings. Across the border from Norway in Sweden, sporadic gang-fueled gun crime just helped to install a far-right anti-immigrant party into power. Both countries have relatively high levels of gun ownership, but low levels of gun-related homicides. Special correspondent Malcolm Brabant went to Scandinavia to see if there are lessons America can learn.
At long last, Norway has a national memorial for the worst attack on its soil since World War II. At this summer's inauguration, friends honoured the 69 young victims massacred 11 years ago on the island of Utøya by right-wing extremist Anders Breivik.
Elisabeth Trønes Lie.
Elisabeth Trønes Lie was 16 years old when she was murdered. Her sister Catherine, then 17, was one of 110 wounded. On the anniversary of the shooting, Catherine posted this image, revealing the exit wound of the round that nearly claimed her life. The everlasting torment of their mother, Marit, is plain to see. Painting provides an outlet for grief and anger from having just two daughters, Catherine and Victoria, instead of three.
This is a painting of my daughters, sisters. Those two I have left. They are comforting each other, and that gives me comfort that they have each other, now that Elizabeth is gone.
What do you think every time you hear that there's been a massacre in America?
I can feel the pain. I really feel it. I can't understand why every American should own a gun and be able to buy a gun. Why?
Here's a comparison between America and Norway in 2020, which was the worst ever year for gun-related deaths in the United States. In America that year, there were 19,384 gun homicides. In Norway, just two. Yes, two. America's population is 60 times that of Norway, so if you were to transfer Norway's figures to the United States, there would have been just 120 deaths instead of nearly 20,000.
Having stood in the wrong end of the gun of a mass shooter is not an experience anyone should ever have.
After surviving Utøya, Bjørn Ihle, now 31, has devoted his life to promoting peace and countering extremism. He hasn't stepped foot on the island since 2014, when he went back with me to the place where the shooter fired at him and missed.
Breivik pointed his gun at me and he fired, and for a moment there I knew I was dead, basically. I collapsed in the water. I guess he just assumed he had hit me or something like that, because he continued just shooting people around me.
When he's not trying to de-radicalize right-wing or Islamic extremists, Ihle lives in the Nordic woods. Tranquility soothes his trauma.
Many of my friends were killed in the attack, and my entire country was changed forever by it.
Go!
Espen Farstad represents Norway's Hunters Association. He's happy that post-Utøya legislation outlawed automatic, semi-automatic, and high-caliber pistols and rifles.
We are very safe. We have 1.3 million guns, civil guns, in the Norwegian society. That means one for every four Norwegian. But we hardly see any crimes.
Norway has some of the world's toughest gun laws. Shotguns and hunting rifles can be purchased following stringent background checks and extensive training. Firearms are seen here primarily as tools for hunting. Farstad believes Americans should emulate Norwegians and tackle what he calls the paranoia of guns for self-defense.
They are playing with their own kids' lives, and I don't think they take it seriously enough. And I think it's sad to see that a heavy organization like the National Rifle Association keep on working like they do for their weapon interest without seeing the big problems they are causing in the society.
But it's impossible for America to be as safe as Norway unless the constitutional right to bear arms is modified. Bjørn Ihle believes the Founding Fathers' intentions, written in an era of single-shot muskets, have been misinterpreted.
I do think there needs to be a change in the culture surrounding guns. Demilitarization, disarmament, really should be the natural conclusion at this point, especially considering the way in which firearms have changed and we now have a much higher degree of high-capacity weapons.
Target practice with a customized AR-15, the weapon of choice for many American mass murderers. In Sweden, it's only available for purchase by sports shooters like champion markswoman Pia Klerte. Across the border from Norway, Sweden also enforces restrictive gun controls. To be granted a Swedish gun license, applicants must be of good character and law-abiding. Hunting and sports guns can only be obtained after 6 months' assessment at a certified club. And then gun owners are monitored by the police every 24 hours.
There is a registry check if you have done any crimes or suspected for any crimes, anything like that. And it can be things like driving too fast or being too drunk in a restaurant, for instance, or in a bar. Those kind of things would make the police check if you have a gun.
Such misdemeanors could result in both gun and license being forfeited. Pierre Clerté believes Sweden's gun laws are tough enough.
In terms of the legal gun owners with a license in Sweden, I would say that is one of the most law-abiding groups as a whole in the Swedish society. Whereas on the other side, you have people who obviously don't care about killing other people, so they are not going to care about having an illegal gun.
Clerté is referring to the gang wars, which in recent years have exploded across Swedish inner cities. In this video, posted on social media, young gangsters show off their Kalashnikov. The rounds hit an empty restaurant in Stockholm, and no one was hurt in this snapshot of Sweden's dark underbelly. Most experts are convinced that the battlegrounds of former Yugoslavia are the source of most illegal weapons. Once smugglers enter the frontier-free European Union, reaching Sweden is easy. Professor Magnus Ranstorp from Sweden's Defence College is an expert on the illegal arms trade.
For example, in Malmö, you can buy automatic weapons for about 10,000, 15,000 Swedish krona, which is about $1,000. You usually get thrown in a couple of hand grenades for free.
Apart from the gang problem, is Sweden a safe country?
Most people are not worried about their family members getting shot, unless they are in socially vulnerable areas, unless they are somehow wrapped up in gang conflict.
That perception was undermined by this hit in a busy mall in Malmö, southern Sweden, on August 19, in which a well-known gang leader was killed. A 39-year-old woman, totally unconnected to the feud, was caught in the spray of bullets. With national elections fast approaching, gun crime and the involvement of teenagers is now a hot issue. The alleged shooter, arrested near the scene, was just 15 years old.
As this is like a spiral of violence, you have to cool the conflict down.
Karin Svanberg heads the Swedish government's inner city crime prevention unit. She acknowledges that Sweden was slow to react to gun violence. It's now applying more robust policing and tougher jail terms.
If you are a violent group, you will get in the focus of the attention from the police. So that creates internal pressure within the group to calm down the conflict.
But Swedes rejected the former centre-left government's light touch on gun crime. With murder rates heading to record highs, in last month's general election, voters turned to a right-wing coalition which promised to get tough on gang crime. There are fears the violence may spread to Norway, a nation desperate for peace after Utøya. After hiding in this kitchen, fleeing through the woods to a beach and being rescued by a boat, Utøya survivor Torbjørn Vereide is in a prime position to shape Norway's future. Now a member of parliament and carrying a torch for his murdered friends, Vereide has this advice for America.
I respect that some people value the right to own and carry guns, but I think that the value of life, the value of the children, the value of the adults that are getting killed every day now is more important, and that we have to decide which principle is the most important.
It took just one mass shooting for Norway to tighten up gun control. There's bewilderment here that America won't follow suit. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Malcolm Brabant in Norway.
Harriet Tubman and Frederick Douglass, two 19th century giants who led the fight to end slavery in America. They are the latest subjects of a filmmaker long engaged in telling the contributions and challenges of African Americans. Jeffrey Brown talks with Stanley Nelson about two new documentaries on PBS for our arts and culture series, Canvas.
What to the American slave is your 4th of July?
The words and work of Frederick Douglass to stir a nation in a film titled Becoming Frederick Douglass.
Northern and Southern newspapers related breathless accounts of Colonel Montgomery's campaign on the Combahee River in South Carolina, led by Harriet Tubman.
The escape from bondage and daring rescue missions of Harriet Tubman to bring others north from Harriet Tubman, Visions of Freedom. Two new films from documentarian Stanley Nelson.
But these two people, with their own agencies, one, freed themselves, and then didn't stop at freeing themselves, but wanted to make sure that other people were freed. And I think that's an important lesson for any age.
What's the last line before her?
Nelson, who we joined recently in the Harlem office of his nonprofit organization Firelight Media, is one of the preeminent chroniclers of a wide range of African American experience. Civil rights history, including the films Freedom Summer,
Is This America? The land of the free and the home of the brave,
and the Black Panthers.
It happened at just the right time.
the role of education in Tell Them We Are Rising.
Black colleges were redefining what it meant to be black in America.
Culture in films like Miles Davis' Birth of the Cool.
Juilliard in the daytime, and at night, he'd be on 52nd Street.
And dozens more. His focus has largely been on the 20th century. In these films, he looks back further.
Right is of no sex. Truth is of no color.
It felt a little bit different. It's harder, you know? It's harder to look back at the 19th century, you know, where you don't have witnesses. You know, you have no archival footage that you can use. But we felt from the very beginning that there's a way to do it, that there's a way to tell their stories, and they're important stories. So let's figure out how to tell them.
We now understand that Frederick Douglass is the most photographed American man in the 19th century. Not African-American man, but American man.
Becoming Frederick Douglass follows the life of a man born into slavery and his journey to becoming an influential leader, a tireless activist and public speaker who learned to use a technology new to his era.
He used his image to further the cause of abolition. Mm-hmm. He's using the camera to say, shh, look at me. Should I be enslaved?
Look at me, a black man, a former slave.
Right, and there's no way that you can't. You just look at the photos and you see the intelligence in his eyes. And, you know, it's just amazing use of photography, you know, like right after photography was invented.
There are just a handful of photos of Harriet Tubman, most as an older woman, and no writings. Nelson focuses on both her extraordinary courage and intelligence, evidenced in the mission she undertook to return south to free others.
It took a lot of planning. It took a lot of knowledge. It took leadership, you know, and she was an incredible human being. We wanted to give that sense of Harriet Tubman. And I think in some ways, that's kind of a new thing.
I don't know how often you have the time or inclination to kind of look back at all the work you've been doing over these years. Do you see a story that you've been telling?
If you add it all up, you know, maybe it's you know, the quest for freedom, you know, in different ways. A lot of my films are about, you know, institutions that are trying to change the world and trying to change the life in the United States. One of the feelings is that that I feel and we feel, you know, at our company Firelight, is that, you know, people should tell their own stories. And in some ways, that's my story. You know, I'm African American. You know, as far back as I can trace, it's in my blood, it's in my guts, it's in my brain. And so, I try to tell stories from that point of view.
Do you feel it as a, I'll even use the word mission, to tell them?
Oh yeah. I'm on a mission. We're on a mission at Firelight. We're on a mission to tell stories that haven't been told, to talk about our past, but for everyone, you know, because, you know, African-American history is American history. I think we only benefit by telling our history, by opening up our history, by making our history accessible to more and more people. And that's one of the things that film does. You know, you might not pick up a 400, 500 page book on Frederick Douglass or Harriet Tubman, but can you spend an hour watching a film? Yeah, and will it enlighten you, hopefully entertain you, maybe even change you? And that's what history does, and I think that it's really important that we understand that, and we look at our history, and we don't try to block history.
A related mission for Nelson and Firelight Media, helping emerging documentary filmmakers of color get their stories made and seen through its documentary lab.
For so much of filmmaking history, documentary history, our stories, you know, as people of color, have been told by other people. And we really feel that you know, there's a need for telling our own stories, that the stories can be a little bit richer, a little bit deeper, if you're telling the stories from the inside.
Nelson's own next projects include a film on the history of policing in Black America, and another on African American art. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown in New York.
Animal rescue organizations across the country are stepping up, working to rehome thousands of beagles recently rescued from a Virginia research and breeding facility. We spent the past month meeting some of these precious pups and the people involved in the massive rescue operation. Here now is our report on who let the dogs out and where they are now.
This is the moment California resident Christo Fan knew she was adopting a puppy, a decision her sister Christine also made. Their pups, Maya and Millie, are two of some 4,000 beagles rescued from a Cumberland, Virginia facility, which bred and sold animals for research.
Even though they've been through so much, they're so good-natured and so trusting of humans.
In July, the Department of Justice secured the release of the beagles after filing a lawsuit against Envigo RMS, alleging that the breeding facility failed to provide, quote, minimum standards for handling, housing, feeding, watering, sanitation, and adequate veterinary care. But relocating 4,000 beagles is no easy task, a massive undertaking spearheaded by the Humane Society of the United States. More than 120 shelters and rescues in 29 states sent volunteers to the facility to pick up the beagles, transport them, and provide medical care.
It's not as simple as just mobilizing 4,000 dogs.
Miguel Abi Hassan, Chief Animal Rescue Officer for the Humane Society of the United States, or HSUS.
Working in this environment can be a little bit tough. You know, ultimately, we're responding to some of the most heinous cruelty situations. But the joy can be found in the work that the animal rescue team does, what we bring to these animals.
I visited one organization that stepped up to assist, Lucky Dog Animal Rescue in Arlington, Virginia.
Now, they don't have a shelter or a kennel, so they rely on a network of volunteers, dozens of people who step up to temporarily house the animals, like Ollie here, in their homes until a permanent home can be found. And this one office helped to rehouse and rescue 30 beagles.
HSUS reached out and basically said, we don't have any information on these dogs other than they're beagles and they're coming from the research facility.
Allie Porter manages the transportation and foster program at Lucky Dog.
The drivers actually went down, picked up the animals, and that was the first time we got anything. So the volunteers were sending us pictures and copies of their medical records while they were driving back. And we just started kind of the list that we had of the fosters that said they could take them. We reached out to them and said, hey, this is what we know about them now.
With adoptions now underway across the country, the hard work is paying off. Angela Speed has worked with Wisconsin's Humane Society for 16 years.
I cannot remember any time when we've had this volume of calls and emails and messages coming into our shelter from people from more than 25 states.
Let's go home, hon. Yeah.
The beagles and their story have pulled at the heartstrings of Americans from coast to coast. 7-year-old Mia got a fairy tale ending, recently adopted by the Duke and Duchess of Sussex, Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, after Mia and 8 of her puppies were rescued.
This is our newest member of the fire department, Captain.
And in Treasure Island, Florida, the local fire department adopted this beagle named Captain.
And it's great to have him around, too. This guy had a traumatic beginning to his life. Our firefighters see a lot of traumatic stuff in the course of their day sometimes, and it's nice for them to be able to come back to the station and have, you know, some unconditional love with Captain.
Last week, we took him out in the fire truck, and he got to ride around in the city with that, and he actually loved being up there looking around. He's just so entertained by seeing, like, the world.
In Long Beach, New York, Lee and her husband Jesse are proud parents to Mandu, whom they adopted in August.
Poppy, who is Mandu's mom, gave birth to the litter the day after she was rescued from the lab.
The couple drove 4 hours round trip to bring their new friend home.
Mandu!
A home she's still getting used to.
She really likes going down to the beach, and when she's on the beach, she just lays down and, like, doesn't walk.
She was described as the spunky one in the litter who kind of always would explore first, jump out of the crated area, and then kind of then everyone else would follow. So we knew we were in for a fun time.
Like so many others who've opened their doors to give these beagles a safe place to call home.
Clearly one of my toughest assignments so far, and I was this close to adding another rescue dog to our home. Not this time. Meanwhile, online, following this broadcast, stay with us on our NewsHour YouTube channel and website for a live discussion on race, redemption, and reentry after incarceration, moderated by Chief Washington correspondent and PBS News weekend anchor Jeff Bennett at Morehouse College. It's part of our series, Searching for Justice. And coming up later this evening, watch the live Arizona Senate debate. Incumbent Senator Mark Kelly will face challengers Blake Masters and Mark Victor. You can tune in tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern. That's at our website, pbs.org/newshour, and on YouTube. Compliments of our colleagues at Arizona PBS. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you for joining us. We will see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. And friends of the NewsHour, including Leonard and Norma Klorfein, and Koo and Patricia Ewan. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour.
PBS.